Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. We give you all the praise and all the glory and all the honor. We humble ourselves before you and say, Lord, here's our heart. We know the teacher is the Holy Spirit. And we thank you, Holy Spirit, for being here. Welcome in this house, your house that you have built by your grace. We give you all the praise, give you all the glory, give you all the honor. We thank you, Jesus, for your presence and exaltation in this place. May it be to your glory and praise at every turn of every road. And Lord, may I just say that we are asking you to bless us tonight with your word and an understanding of your word so we could be deeper, greater, bigger, stronger, healthier Christians on this planet that is lost and dying and failing in every area. But we'd like to be the light to a lost and dying world. So help us to do that. And God will give you the praise and give you the glory. We thank you, Father, that there are other churches that are meeting tonight besides the Rock. Our Baptist brothers, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalian, Charismatics, Pentecostals. We thank you for Calvary Chapels and Harvest, Oak Valley and Oasis and Inland Christian Center. We thank you, Father, for the great churches that are out there, our Adventist brothers and sisters, Catholic brothers and sisters. At no time, Lord, are we thinking of ourselves as better than them. No, sir. We are seeing that we are co-laborers, workers together in one field, and we are preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Different ways, different methods, different tactics to do so, reaching everybody at wherever they're at. Your wisdom being applied in the different facets of churches that are out there. If they're preaching the gospel, they're our brothers and our sisters, and we ask you to bless them also, as you would bless us this night. Jesus' mighty name, with a great big shout, we all say, amen. Amen. Come on, you can do better than that. With a great big shout, you could say what?
Amen.
That's more like it. I've been pondering the word of the Lord for 40 years and taking my time because I'm not a good reader. I used to think, for those of you that are not good readers, that you had to be a good reader to ever be a good teacher. Nothing could be further from the truth. A good teacher is somebody who doesn't read fast, but someone who reads and understands with depth and precision what's being said. For the last week, I've been meditating and realizing that there's a verse that we often use that's from the words of Jesus, and it's a profound statement. When I use the word profound, I mean it's a statement that is dynamic and exciting and alive and full of depth and has the ability to go deep inside of each and every one of us. This is profound. And it changes us if we understand this purpose. I might just say to all of us that we're here tonight is that we're born on this planet for something. God didn't just have you here as part of the multitude of billions of people on the planet. This is not some scientific, if you will, heavenly experiment that you're here. There is a purpose, there's a destiny, and there's a reason. And most people that call themselves Christians have no concept of the purpose and destiny that God has for them, other than maybe dying someday and going to heaven. But while they're on this journey, they have no idea how or what to do to be what God would have them to be. And how sad is that? That should not be you. That should not be me. That we should understand that the Word of God is making a statement that can change our lives and give us exactly what we're looking for in every area of our life. God wants to bless you. You'd have to be a spiritual moron to not believe that God, who loves you, wants to bless you like any good father would love to do. And when Jesus makes statements, like we're going to read tonight one verse, that I'm telling you we could teach on for a week. There wouldn't be anybody in the room a week from now. Not even Deborah, she'd go home. But we could teach on this profound verse. So I've entitled the message, Profound Words of Jesus. because they are life changing if you understand the depth of them. Here's what we do oftentimes, too many times, is we'll read the scripture trying to put in time and verses. Like people will say, you got to read one chapter a day. You know, and you read that chapter, that's all fine. I'm not belittling that by any means. I think that's great and wonderful. But if you don't get anything out of it, and it's just you're doing it out of routine, then you miss everything that's being said in there. And that's why going slow and thinking about what's being said and who's saying it makes all the difference in the world. I want to take you to John, the 14th chapter. I don't know how many sessions we'll have on profound words of Jesus, but I started with this one because it just kind of popped into my heart and I couldn't get rid of it all week long, especially one part of it. John, the 14th chapter, is powerful, by the way. If you want to read an excellent reading for yourself, just stop everything during the week and you'll read in the morning or read at night and you want to get a few verses in and want to try to think about some things. Jesus is speaking a lot here. And he's making tremendous statements about his relationship with the Father with him. And he's talking to his disciples and he's questioning them and asking for answers back from them. And he's not getting very good answers. And he makes a statement that is a statement that we often have heard, but it just kind of blows over our head. Has anybody ever been there? And you never really thought about the statement too much. Tonight, I want to show you something. When I read the statement, you will know the words that Jesus is making. You have heard it before. And you will think there's only three things that Jesus is saying in this verse, but it's not. It's so much deeper than that. There's actually six major points being made in one verse. So this could really go 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different messages. In verse number 6 of the 14th chapter, Jesus is speaking to his disciples. He makes this statement. I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. Like I said, we've all heard that. That's not new to all of us. We could all quote that. That's not something that aren't familiar with. We're very familiar with this verse. But I've outlined six areas, and I've highlighted them for you that are fascinating areas that show how deep and profound this word of God really is. First one, and I'm going to go through all of them, but let me read it again. Here you can see them in highlighted words. I am way, truth, life, no one, me. Six major things that we want to chat about. I can give you verses for all of them. I'm not going to tonight, because if I did, we'd be here for an hour, hour and a half, and then on the way home, Debbie would beat me all up. And so I'd say I preach way too long, which I usually do too much anyway. And she's 100% right. But I want to share some things with you about some of them, if I may. And let's take a look this night, and let's look together, because he's saying something to his disciples that has been held in Scripture for thousands of years. Now watch this. Has been protected for thousands of years so that you tonight could look at the words of Jesus and get something out of this other than just blowing through the verse and say, yes, amen. And oftentimes we use this verse as something that says that nobody goes to heaven but by him. But what if I was to tell you tonight, as we look at this verse, he's saying so much more than just that. We think about it in those terms. First of all, let's just discover something as we look. The very first thing, first of all, before I ever say anything, I gotta lay this out for you. Jesus doesn't use words that are just words. Doesn't just fill in the blanks. Idle conversation. You've known people that, I was listening to people talk the other day. We were on an airplane in line before we got on the airplane. We were just listening to people around us talking, and the subjects were so shallow and just words that meant nothing. If you ever stop in your life and listen to other people, you'll find that most people talk a lot and they don't mean anything. The words don't really evolve to very much at all. But Jesus is very different than that concept. And sometimes we take that concept and don't understand that what Jesus is saying is absolutely ringing the bell from the beginning of time to this very day. when he makes a statement, when he says something, his something means something more than usually any one of us, and certainly me, can ever think about. And that's why we need to go slow and look at this just for tonight. Change your life if you're interested. Amen. Really give you some real great insight. I am is the first one. So hold your place there, if you will, in John 14 chapter. In fact, we're going to keep coming back to John 14 chapter, but I'm going to take you in a few different places, and let's take a look at it together. He makes this statement, I am. And a lot of people don't understand what he's really saying. What he's really saying is, I am everything. I'm the air you breathe. I'm the warmth of the sun. I'm the creator that holds the planet in its place, or it all fly off. I'm the one that holds the atmosphere, the moon in its right axis so the water doesn't flood the land. I'm the one that keeps the sun at a certain distance so it doesn't come too close and we all burn, or be too far that we all freeze. I'm everything. Moses is talking to God. It's an interesting conversation in Exodus, if you will. The third chapter, you might want to go there with me and hold your place, like I said, in John. We're going to be doing a lot of John tonight. But in Exodus, the third chapter, Moses is talking to God. You know, it's really fascinating when you've got scripture of a man talking to God for literally chapters. You won't find that very few places in the Bible. That there's a man talking to God back and forth for chapters, not just a little word here, I heard God's voice here, moved on in two verses, something. I would talk about chapters of what God says to Moses. And he's asking Moses to go back to the children of Israel who've been in captivity for 400 years to the Egyptians. Moses is like 80 years old, and he says, I want you to go back before Pharaoh. In fact, before you go to Pharaoh, there's a bigger job you have, and you're going to have to convince Israel that you're a spokesman for them. Israel is probably very negative about life about this time. 400 years of captivity and slavery to the Egyptians. They lived in poverty. They lived in hardships. They lived in sickness. They've been crying out and hadn't heard anything from God. And here comes a guy named Moses, an old guy that's going to say, I'm going to speak for you and before God, and I'm going to see that God delivers you. God wants to deliver you. And these people are really, they're not too keen to the idea, if you want to know the truth. In fact, I wouldn't be, neither would you, if somebody came along, tried to tell you that he's the one that's going to, you know, follow the ways of God. So he asked God, he's actually trying to talk God out of telling him to go. He didn't want to go. I don't blame him. I'd probably do the same thing, so would you. But it was kind of interesting because at one time he says to God, he says, God, if I'm going to go to these people, I know what they're like. Who should I tell them sent me? In other words, who are you? You stop and think about that. God, you want me to go risk my life? Who are you? What should I tell them is your name? You know, sometimes when we hear about a name, especially in other parts of the world, the name reflects about the person, you know, happiness, joy. You'll find blessings, the name blessing. You'll find actually names that reflect what the person does. In this particular case, and I'm just going to put it up on the overhead for you, in the third chapter, verse number 14, if you'll take a look at it with me, God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he makes this statement, and he said, thus you shall say to the children of Israel, I am has sent me to you. God doesn't say, I'm the great tree in the sky. I'm the great eagle that's flying above the land. I'm the great one who, God makes a statement, everything there is that exists, I am that. Now, don't misunderstand me and run off and say that God is in that. I'm saying to you that God created that. In other words, I'm not telling you that God is in the tree. He just created the tree. In other words, we go along with a whole bunch of dumb people start worshiping trees. Say it's God. So don't do that. I'm not saying that. So let's make that very clear. What I'm saying is that God is the creator of everything that exists. And you, my friends, exist. You stop and you think about that. God couldn't put a name on himself except, well, I am. Well, what? I'm everything. Everything that exists in this natural world, God spoke from the spiritual realm and came into being, and he's still creating in the eons of atmospheres that are out there. I am. And that's who God is. And that is something that a lot of times we don't realize. That you, my friend, when God wants to identify with you, and God wants to live inside of you. Now watch this. And God wants to do something with your life because he's got a purpose and a destiny for you. It's not just some guy that's cool, that's got a lot of money. It is God, the creator of everything. You are, and I are hooked up to him, the creator of everything. Amen. There is. Amen. The great and magnificent I am. And you, if you're born of the Spirit of God, are a child of I am. Who's going to mess with you? If Papa comes running. And he does. Take it back to the New Testament. Jesus makes a statement once again. If you'll go with me. And this is a kind of a cool statement that he makes in John. Let's take a look at it again. Go back to the book of John. This time the 8th chapter of John. Second to the last verse in the 8th chapter of John, it says this in verse 58. Yes, it is. Second to the last verse in the 8th chapter of John. Jesus said to them, "Most assuredly I say unto you, before Abraham was," he just identified himself with a creator of everything that exists. Existence comes, as you know it, from the I am. And Jesus is the I am. So when he goes back, go back with me now to John 14 chapter once again. And he goes back to John 14 chapter in verse number 6. He makes this statement. He comes along and he says in John 14 chapter, I am. He wasn't just saying, I am. Like, common conversation, I am. Hey, it's what I do, you know. Watching two guys meeting together the other day, two old guys like me, you know, I'm a bit old in my 70s, and a bunch of old guys around, you know, and everybody says, well, what did you do? And what do you do? And what did you do in life? You know, and they finally get around to me. I wish they wouldn't get around to me. Because it's like somebody pulled the shade down in everybody's face. Well, I'm a pastor of a great church. A pastor? Oh, well, and I'm telling you, we've had people, this is true, within the last 30 days, literally turn like this and walk away from us. I just as soon say, I'm a crook or a robber, they would probably stay and say, let's have a beer or something. You know, I don't know. The guys are a mess. But here's God making this statement. I am. You and I have a life ahead of us, if we should choose this life, to have the great I am every day with you. Oh my goodness. And Jesus isn't making that statement just as common conversation, because he has nothing else to say about who he was. I am. The second thing we see in these words that are wonderful tonight is this I am, and I love this word, if you will, the way. And you might as well put it up. I really capitalized the word the, because he did not say he was a way. Yeah. Like they have a way. They have a way. And don't men have a lot of ways, you know what I mean? There's always got a way to do something. If you ever talk to anybody, they're always ready to give you every kind of instruction in the world. Why? Because they know the way. It might be good for their way, but it isn't the way. And there's a difference between a way than the way. And along with the word the way comes two other words that are dynamic. One is the word direction. The other is the word follower. Because if he is the way, the creator of the heavens and the earth, everything that exists, he's saying something here. He says, I want to give you directions. And if you're smart, you'll follow. Amen. Why? Because I know how existence works. But everybody else has a way. Everybody else has a formula. Everybody else has a plan. Everybody else has a direction. And you know, all through your life, somebody is going to give you direction, and somebody you're going to follow. And who gives you direction and who you follow determines, I've said it 1,000 times, where you end up. And where you end up is determined by who gave you the directions and whether you followed them. So what happens is we have a whole frustrated community called Christians, because they are Christians, but they're still looking for a way, their way, and want and want God to get on their way. And God says, no, it doesn't work that way. I don't get on board your way in order for you to be prosperous, successful, healthy, and blessed in every area of your life. Trust me, I know what existence is all about. You're going to have to get on my way. And Jesus makes this statement. It's kind of a cool statement. Once again, if you want to take a look at it with me, in John the 8th chapter, go back there again, just down a few pages, in verse, if you will, in verse number 12. Jesus spoke to them. He makes this statement. He says, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light. Not just a light. Hey, guys, hear what he's saying. Shall have the light, not just a light that guides your path, but the light of life. Amen. In other words, he comes and he makes this statement that I am the way, and in your life, you're going to get, he has to make that statement because he knows mankind. In mankind, ever since the fall of Adam and Eve, where they partook of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, from that point on, they started making their own way. First moments of their existence, first thing they did was observe that they were naked and started to cover themselves up because of insecurity. They never had that before. And they start to now plan and make their own way. Did you know that's been going on for thousands of years? Even though the Redeemer has come and washed us with his blood. Because here's what happens. He washes with blood. We're settled for heaven. But we haven't learned to do things his way. We're still following for a way. Hopefully it's our way. So God gets involved in our way instead of his way. Amen. And we find ourselves in a place of being a mess. And Jesus says, if you'll just do some, follow me, shall not walk in darkness. Can I say this? If you're not walking in darkness, then you'll be walking in light of life, and you can't fail. And that's what God, who loves you so much, says. See, most people don't get that. I mean, they're just waiting as Christians that God would just send Tinkerbell and fly over and have magic gold dust fall on them, and some people get blessed and some people don't. But here there's actually this whole entire thing that Jesus is saying, because he cares so much about us that he's telling us there's a very important process here. First thing is, I am. I am the very thing of all existence. I know it. Now, I will show you how to navigate. I will give you the directions, and you will have the life, light of life, not the darkness of life. See, a lot of people live in darkness even though they've been set free from the darkness. And you know it, and I know it. You know Christians that are just bummed out, down, discouraged, frustrated, their kids aren't serving God, and they just hate everything and everybody. You know that. And it's so sad. Because Jesus makes a statement from a familiar verse that we all can quote that says something. I want to give you the directions. You just need to follow me. And if you follow me, you'll never be in that darkness, which means you'll always end up in the right place for life. Whew. What a powerful statement. Third thing he says, which is really great, he says, I'm the way. If you'll go back with me in John 14, chapter 1, number 6, let's put it up on the, is this, I am the way. And he comes along, he says, and then he says, truth. I'm the truth. So go ahead, here's number three, the truth. Let me just give you an insight of what he's saying. There's a lot of people out there with suggestions, but his is the right one. He is not a truth, like these people may have a truth, and it may be a truth for them. It may be a truth for them, but it won't get them to where they want to be and where God wants to take them. It'll get them maybe like, let me give you a truth. You work hard, study hard, get a good job, you'll have a great paying job, you have a nice house, nice car, hopefully you have a nice little family and all that stuff. That's a truth, but it won't take you to where the truth needs to take you, for where God wants to bless you in so many areas. See, there's a truth out there that we oftentimes follow, but it's not the truth that takes us to the ultimate goal plan that God has for our lives. Is anybody listening? Did you get that? So there's a lot of truth out there pertaining to the person or pertaining to the situation or pertaining to life as we understand it on this planet as humans, but it's not the truth that'll take you to the ultimate place of existence. And the creator of existence, the great I am, who wants to give you the directions that you're to follow so that you might have the light of life, says, my directions and my ways are the ultimate truth. Which is, I don't know about you, but I want to follow. In fact, here we are, just for fun, if I may, use the two presidential candidates. I don't know that either one of them know how to tell the truth. Am I the only one that feels that way? It's like I one day I'm mad at him, and the next day I'm disgusted with her. Next day I think she might have it, and then the next day I'm thinking he might have it. Why? Because I'm thinking, who has the truth? It's like we have so fallen apart in this country that right is wrong, wrong is right. And the laws of this land is a truth for the laws of the land, but may not be a truth for God. Let me give you an illustration of that. Here we have the Supreme Court telling us about marriage. And it may be the truth for this land, but let me tell you, saints, it ain't the truth for God. And see, so there are different types of truth. But God comes along and he makes this statement, I am the truth. In other words, you can go to the heavenly bank. See, does anybody remember Security Pacific? How about Washington Mutual? Remember those banks? Oh, they were big, they were solid, they were healthy. Yes, we can bank on them. Let me tell you who you bank on, the truth. The one who's a creator and exister of all. His name is Jesus. In John the 8th chapter, again, it's kind of fun going back and forth between John the 8th chapter and John 14th chapter. But go back there with me in John the 8th chapter once more again. In verse number 31, Jesus speaking to and said to these Jews who believed him. And here's a key to finding out what's truth for your life. So you get the right direction to have the light of life, so the one who created existence can bless you in every area of your life. There's tremendous truth here. So he's talking to these people who are believing in him and they're Jews, and he makes a statement in verse number 31. If you abide, and I'm going to stop you right there. And I don't know if you guys in the back room have the ability to do this on the fly like this, but see the word abide up there? If you could highlight that word abide, because it means so much more than just what we think. The word abide, he says this. He says, if you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed. The word abide, see it up there? It means to live, so watch this, to stay and to dwell. Now, I live, stay, and dwell here on this planet. I live, stay, dwell at a restaurant. I live, stay, dwell by the way I think. And God says, if you can live, stay, and dwell, and listen to these words, in my word, you're my disciples indeed, which is cool, but we're talking about truth. Watch this, verse 32. Go to verse 32, thank you. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you what? Free. You know, you're not just free because of positive thinking. You're free because you know the difference between the voices who's giving you wrong directions and those that are giving you right directions. That's called mature Christianity. You know the existence of the great I Am who cares about us and wants to associate with us and wants to bless us. And he says, I want to give you the right directions in life so that you can live, stay, and dwell in light of life. Never in the darkness that you came out of. Never having the darkness in your home or with your children or with your finances or dreams or vision or destiny or purpose. Know that you have the existence of life based upon what he says, and it all comes by truth, because when you get that and apply it in your life, it does something. It literally makes you free. Can I ask you a question? Free from what? Free from the systems that are trying to guide you constantly, trying to manipulate you constantly, trying to get you on their side. Free from, you know, you're in this world, but not of it. And you're free. Doesn't matter. I'm so free. Can I just tell you something? I hate to say this. I don't care if they elect Mickey Mouse. God's going to take care of me. And I don't want to be mean or crude or anything such as that, because I'm really respectful of our presidents. I really love whomever it will be, I will love. But I really have to tell you, if they ran Mickey Mouse, I would vote for Mickey Mouse. And so that's the way I kind of feel about that. And so I'm free enough not to put my trust in this world system and whether or not everything's going to get along, because I know the one who created existence is on my side. So I'm free. Because I'm going to follow him no matter what. The whole world can go one way, and the church can go another way, but I'm going where Jesus goes. How about you? You see, and we can shout and clap and say, oh, that's wonderful, but you can't do that until you become a disciple, which is a learner of his word. Because it's in his word that is described here as what word? Truth. Is that good? All right, go back with me, if you will, John 14th chapter. He not only makes those great statements, but he says the last one I want to just share with you that's really important to me. In John 14th chapter, geez, I've so run out of time. I'm so sorry. Is the word, and this is a great word, life. most important to me of all of them. Look, I'm thoroughly convinced that we do not understand in American churches what real life is. I said that slowly so you couldn't misunderstand me. I'm thoroughly convinced in American churches that we do not understand what real life is. Now, with that understanding, with me, my comment that I just made with you, and without the understanding of that, let me describe to you what life is. Life for most Christians is the accumulations of things. The other day I was watching somebody sit in a comfortable chair in a store, and there's one of those chairs you lean back. Debbie and I were in a store, and I leaned back and the chair was vibrating, and he made this comment to his wife, "Now this is the life." You've heard it a million times in your life. That's not the life. Life is not in those things that you accumulate. Now listen, I'm going to put a parenthesis in here. Even though God wants you to accumulate them. But life is not in the things you accumulate. Life is in whom you relate with and who's in your heart. He is the bread of life, Jesus, which simply means this. It's what's so fascinating to me is that the word bread in the Bible is found as a sustaining force, substance of your life. You can exist with bread. And Jesus is described as the bread of life. So all of a sudden what we do, now watch this, here's the way most people figure out life. I will accumulate for my life. And at the end of my life, when I've accumulated and achieved all these goals and all of these directions, I have had life. But Jesus makes a statement that says it like this, and it might frustrate you. What good is it if a man prospers and gains the whole world but loses his soul? And that's why you see so many great movie stars and singers and rock stars that have hundreds of millions of dollars committing suicide. Why? Because they could not handle life. Because they made life on this planet their goal. Instead of having God as their goal and their source of life, stuff became the source of life. So what we do is we accumulate all these things. We have these jobs, we have this education, we have all this stuff, and then we say, God, come in and bless my life. And God makes a statement, seek first the kingdom of heaven and all of his righteousness, then I will add these things to your life. So he's not against you having them, it's just about what order they come. And if you're going after the life of the world, it's impossible for you to get the life of God. And so most people call themselves Christian are still dealing with the life of the world instead of realizing that real life comes from God. Now, wait a minute. If real life comes from God, then it isn't a matter of how long you live. It's a matter of how well you live. And so what we do is we fall apart when someone young dies in Christ Jesus, because we do not understand that life doesn't come with time on this earth accumulating things. Life comes from the creator of existence, the great I am. And when you understand that, my friends, then all of a sudden everything falls in line. So it doesn't matter if I live long, doesn't matter if I live short, it matters how I live. I don't have a great life because I live well. I have a great life because he is wonderful. Are you following me? So we made that statement. Now, let's go back, if you will. I'm going to just run through the last two real quick for you so we can just conclude this. John 14, chapter verse number 6. Is that okay? And he makes this statement. And number 5, he says, and no one. No man. There isn't any other place for you to look except Jesus. There's no man. No person. No hero. I'm telling you, Captain America isn't going to come. X-Men aren't going to come. Nobody, Superman's not coming. Batman's not coming. Wonder Woman's not coming. I'm here to tell you there's only one. And I don't care what anybody says, his name is Jesus. And at that knee, every knee will bow in heaven and in earth. Because there's only one. And that's a very powerful statement. It's not like we should be looking for somebody else or who's going to lead us. He's the one that wants, the one who made existence wants to lead us, give us direction. He wants to shine that light that'll help us to get to where we need to be. And we need to put our hearts completely on him and not on these things of this earth. Whether you live here a long time, accumulate a lot, or don't have anything, I'm here to tell you life comes when you have him, and it comes from one. Only one. His name is Jesus. And then he made this last statement, number six, me. No man goes to the Father except by, number six, me. And I just say this to you. Oftentimes we say that in reference to getting saved. He wasn't talking about getting saved at all when he's talking to his disciples in the 14th chapter. Not at all, but we pull that out of context. Not that it doesn't work. It does work. It's absolutely 100% right in reference to getting saved. No man goes to the Father except by me. Always, not only goes to the Father in heaven and have eternal life, I do agree with that. And you can use the verse for that. But can I just say this to you? It goes much greater than that. No man can have anything and go to the Father for it without Jesus. There's no middle men. His name is Jesus. And if you want to go to the Father in the name of Jesus, Father, I'm in him and he's in me and I'm making my petitions known. And in that very same chapter, chapter 14, he makes this statement, ask what you will in my name and I'll do it for you. All because there isn't anybody else but Jesus. Six great points. I am the way, the truth, the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. 100% Jesus. Amen. The author and finisher of our faith. End of life. If God spoke to you tonight, come on, give the Lord a great big praise. Sorry it took so long. I just want to just share this with you before you get up and leave, and I'll let you go in just a minute. So could I have you guys just to relax for a moment and give me just a moment more? How sad it would be for you to come in and hear this about Jesus and walk out of this place thinking you're a Christian, and when you're not. Jesus makes a statement, and he makes this statement to a group of people. He says, go from your work of iniquity, I know you not. And they made a comment back to Jesus. They said, what do you mean you don't know us? Have we not cast out demons in your name? I mean, you got to know something about Jesus to cast out demons in his name, right? He says, they said, have we not done many works, godly works in your name? In order to do godly works in his name, you have to know something about Jesus. Knowing something about Jesus, then he makes a statement about them. He says, go from your work of iniquity. I know you not. Wait a minute. We cast out demons in your name. Wait a minute. We know who you are. We prophesied in your name. Wow. You see, there's a lot of people that have head knowledge about who Jesus is, but don't have heart knowledge. And you can't get saved because you know who Jesus is. I already know you know who Jesus is. Of course you do. So listen to what I'm going to say to you. You want to do it the right way. Jesus makes that statement, and it's a great statement. No man goes to the Father except by me. You can't get there any other way but his way. You can't get to the Father. You can't get to heaven. You can't even get your answered prayers without Jesus. You're not going to make it. He's the very source of you getting to the life of existence that he created. And here we are in American churches, and we sing songs, we clap our hands, we call ourselves a Christian. And I don't know, maybe I'm wrong, but I wonder how many God really knows. Remember, he said, go from your work community, I know you're not. I wonder how many. I mean, how many of you have cast out demons in his name recently? How many of you have prophesied in his name? Probably none of you. But yet, sometimes we call ourselves a Christian. And did you know you can't really be a Christian because you call yourself a Christian or you know who Jesus is? I mean, if you can become a Christian because you know who Jesus is, then is it not true that Satan would be a Christian because he knows who Jesus is and every devil in hell would know it because he knows who Jesus is. They know who Jesus is. So it's not what you have in your head that counts for eternal life. It's what you've done with your heart. Now, here's the fascinating part about this. Jesus makes a statement, and he says this statement, you must be born again. And he makes this statement. He makes this statement to a guy by the name of Nicodemus. Nicodemus is a funny little name, John 3rd chapter. Nicodemus, I mean, it's like, why would you say that to Nicodemus, Jesus? Nicodemus was like, if you will, the coolest spiritual person you ever knew. I mean, listen to this. He memorized the scripture. He quoted scripture, debated the scripture, sang the scripture. He debated the scripture. So he knew the word of God, right? He was a leader in his church, a leader in the synagogue, but his church. He fed the poor, took care of the poor, wore ecclesiastical robes, and served God the Father. And Jesus, instead of coming along and saying to him, good job, man. Wow, well done. You did a tremendous job. You're going to love heaven. Heaven's waiting for you. He comes to Nicodemus as an example for us to learn from, and he makes this statement to Nicodemus, you must be born again. And Nicodemus goes, wait a minute. I don't know what you're talking about. And then he comes along and he makes another statement. To be born again, you follow the heartbeat of God, the character, nature, and attributes of God, plus his word. From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, you know what God's after? All of your heart and all of your life. Now listen to what I'm going to say to you because it's bizarre. It is an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. It's either you're in or you're out. It's all or nothing. I'll prove it to you by the scripture. Jesus in the book of Revelation comes along and makes this statement. He says, I'm coming again, and you know he is. And he says, and when I come, I better find you hot or I better find you cold. Because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Oh, wow, what a rude, crude statement. I'll vomit you from my mouth. In other words, you will not be able to continue in the body. I'll vomit you from my mouth. So lukewarm people who call themselves Christians end up not being real Christians at all. Why didn't somebody tell me? It is an all or nothing relationship from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible. That's why we have so many church splits. That's why we have so many church problems. That's why we have so many fights in churches. That's why there's so much garbage in churches, because the people that are not right with God. In order for you to get right, born again, you got to give God all of your heart. You got to give God all of your life. Listen, it's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. Here we are tonight, safe place. We've laughed, we've clapped. You were great listening to the word of God tonight. We've sung songs. Weren't they wonderful? You're great people. You could have been anywhere tonight, but you came to church. You heard about Jesus. You heard about how great he is and how much he loves you and how much he wants for your future and tells you the path to go on. Here it all starts with you giving God all of your heart and giving God all of your life. Without that, my friends, nothing will ever work. That's part of the existence that he has to offer you that is going to bless you, and it's part of you following his directions. You must be born again, Jesus says. So here we are in this safe, friendly place.
And some of you know tonight you haven't yet given God all of your heart and you haven't yet given God all of your life. You know him in your head. You celebrate Christmas. You celebrate Easter. You go to church once in a while. You can even quote scripture, but that doesn't make you a Christian. And tonight is your night of salvation to give God all of your heart, give God all of your life. You say, Pastor Jim, how do I do it? Let's do it God's way. Is that okay instead of my way or your way or some well-meaning church committee's way? Let's do it God's way. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I'll deny you. So in a moment, I'll count to three. Is that okay? I'll go like this. One, here's what it'll sound like. One, two, three, and I'll go, bang! And you hear my hands pop together. Bam! That's for you now at that moment to raise your hand and say, I want to give Jesus all of my heart and all of my life, be born again, headed for heaven. Now watch this. Here's what your hand means, and denying my presence in hell. I don't want to go to hell. And tonight, you can give Jesus right in this safe, friendly place, all of your heart and all of your life. Listen, I don't care if you have a Bible on your lap. I don't care if you went to seminary school. That doesn't mean anything. I don't care if you've been preaching the gospel for 40 years. Doesn't mean a thing. If you haven't given him all of your heart and haven't given him all of your life, because you know why you got to give it to him? Because he's not a thief to rob it from you. He's not a conniver, a manipulator to make you do it. It's a free will choice you get to make Jesus the Lord and Savior of your life. And if you don't do that, then I've done all I can to tell you the truth and make it easy for you to understand. It's your call, it's your decision, and so be it. You've made the choice. But you don't have to make that. You say, Pastor, if you want me to raise my hand, man, I'd be embarrassed. The people I came with would see me. People behind me would see me. I would feel really funny, man. I'd just like, I want to hide. Can I tell you something? Don't let anybody talk you out of this right now. Listen to me what I'm telling you. Don't let anything disturb you. Yes, you might feel embarrassed putting your hand up. Yep, you might. But get over it. It's better to be embarrassed in a safe and friendly place like this than be in hell forever and ever because you are afraid more of what people think instead of what God sees. Tonight is your night of salvation. Who should raise their hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? You know who you are. You know, a little here and a little there. You know, you're not afraid of God. You're not against God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Get ready to put your hand up. You're one of those people that haven't given him all of your heart. You know who you are. You're holding back on him, get ready to put your hand up. You haven't given him all of your life. Say, look, I want to trade my life for your life. I'm in this place waiting for you to get your hand up in a minute. I'll clap to three. We'll clap our hands. Hands are already getting ready to go up, but we'll do it all together at the same time. Is that all right? If you're one of those people that are in here and you're saying, I'm not sure if I should, Pastor Jim. Should I do it? Should I? Yep, you should. Make sure. What could it hurt? What could it hurt? What could it hurt? Here's what it'll hurt. It'll hurt the devil who wants to take you down because you're going to become a child of God, the one who created all existence. Can you imagine this? Is waiting for you to come home tonight. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, I'm going to count to three. Get your hand up. Let me see it. Don't be afraid. Who cares what anybody thinks? And then you can put it right back down. As simple as that. Simple as that. Here it is. Ready? One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. There's one, two, three, four, five. Thank you. Six. Back over here. Thank you. Back there. There's seven. There's eight. There's nine. There's 10. Thank you. God bless you. 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. Back over here. Thank you. There's 19. Anybody else real quick? Where are you? Number 20. You know you need to get your hand up. You want to do it. There's how many do we have back there? 2, 20, 21. Thank you. Anybody else? There's 21 wise people. Anybody else? Isaac, get in there and help them to get out of there in a minute. So anybody else? There's 22 wise people. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Well, let's give the Lord a great big praise for 22 wise people. Wise. Not afraid. Okay, stop just for a minute. Some of you just said to yourself, I should have done that. I just heard God speak that to me in my heart. I don't care. Remember? That's what God spoke. He says, they said, I should have done that. I'm going to let you get your hand up right now. There's 22. Where are you? 23? Where are you? There you are back there. You just said that. Did we say you that laughed about that? Because God just told on you, didn't he? There's 23. Anybody else? Anybody else that said that to yourself that you wish you raised your hand or felt like you should have because you thought you got away, but you didn't get away? God stopped this old man. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Well, 23. Now you give the Lord a great big hand for 23. Okay. All 23 of you, even in the family rooms, I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, friend. Get your stuff. No weird stuff. Nobody leaves during this period of time. Is that okay? I want you to get out of your seat, get in the aisle, meet me right here in front. And wait a minute. You're not going to want to come. Who cares? Tell your flesh to shut up. You're no longer following your flesh anymore. You're going to start following the creator of existence. Come on, get out of your seat, bring your stuff. Meet me right here in front. You come right now. Come on, come on, come on. Anybody that didn't raise their hand, anybody that didn't raise their hand but you should have, you come right now too. Come on, come on, come on. If you didn't raise your hand, you come too right now. Come on, come on, come on. Oh, they're coming. Give them a hand as they come. They're coming. Give them a hand as they come. They're coming. Give them a hand as they come. Oh, they're still coming. Give them a hand. You come too. Come on. Just get your stuff and get out of your seat. Well, thank God you guys have come. This put a smile on your face. You're not going to the morgue, man. You're going to heaven. This is the best day of your life. Are you kidding me? This is just so super. Hey, I want you to look over to your left. You see this guy? He's a Reverend Antonio. Antonio is a great guy. No weird stuff goes on. He's going to do three things. I want to tell you what they are so that you won't, you know, be concerned. Easy stuff, okay? First, he's going to lead you all in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You need to invite him in. He doesn't come in because you walk forward or raise your hand. He comes in. He's a gentleman because you invite him to come in, okay? So he'll lead you in a prayer. He'll go slow, lead you in a prayer. Second thing he's going to do is give you some free information about what to do next. You know, a lot of people come to give their heart to Jesus. They don't know what to do next. They go, ooh, what do I do now? Well, this information, I wrote it, so you got to read it. It's third grade reading level. You know why? Third grade reading level. And that doesn't mean my brain's third grade. I just don't read real good. I go real slow and digest everything like a billion times. And so here's the deal on that. You're going to love it. It's easy to read. It'll tell you what to do next. Third thing he's going to do is tell you about a program we have called Spiritual Personal Trainers. They are fun people to meet. We give away friends here. They'll meet you before church service, buy you coffee, tea, nachos, cookies, answer your questions, share a little scripture with you. Just fun, you know, just enjoy coming to church and not being alone, but coming to church, knowing somebody, and help you get strong. You need godly friends. Ungodly friends will suck you back to the bars. Godly friend, am I talking the truth? Ungodly friends will bring you to church. So it only takes a few minutes. People you came with, they'll wait for you. Make a left turn, follow Antonio right over there. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise.